Heavenly Father, our Lord and our God, you have called us all to be holy. Through the prayers and example of Saint Marguerite Bourgeoys, help us to love you more fully and serve you more faithfully. Bless this statue and let it remind us of her love and devotion for you. Father, we ask this grace through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Saint Marguerite of Canada, your praise we proudly sing. Your constancy, your spirit thrills by the colonists of the Marie. Your charity embraced both friend and foe. The love of God you wanted all to know. The light of truth you planted firm in this fair land of Canada. Saint Marguerite of Canada, you travel sea to sea in search of workers to sow the seeds of truth and love.
Thank you.
have come together to dedicate this altar by offering the sacrifice of Christ. May we respond to these holy rites, receive God's word with faith, share at the table of the Lord with joy, and raise our hearts in hope. Gathered around this one altar, we draw nearer to Christ, the living stone, in whom we become God's holy people. But first, let us ask God to bless this water as it is sprinkled upon us and upon this altar. May it be a sign of our repentance and a reminder of our baptism. God of mercy, you call every creature in the light of faith and surround us with such great love that when you be stray, you continually lead us back to Christ our Lord. For you have established an inheritance of such mercy that those sinners who pass through water made sacred die with Christ to rise restored as members of his body and heirs to his eternal covenant. Bless this water. Sanctify it, as it is sprinkled upon us and upon this altar. Make it a sign of saving waters of baptism, by which we become one in Christ, the temple of your Spirit. May all here today, and all those in days to come, who will celebrate your mysteries on this altar, be united at last in the holy city of your peace. We ask this in the name of Jesus, the Lord.
Amen.
Oh.
lifted high on the altar of the cross. Fill your church, we pray, with heavenly grace as she dedicates to you this altar, the table at which you will plentifully nourish the faithful you gather as one, and will shape day by day through the outpouring of the Spirit a people consecrated to yourself. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen. saying, "Teacher, we know that you are sincere and teach the way of God in accordance with truth, and show deference to no one, for you do not regard people with partiality. Tell us then, what do you think? Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not?" But Jesus, aware of their malice, said, "Why are you putting me to the test, you hypocrites? Show me the coin used for the tax." And they brought him a denarius. Then he said to them, "Whose head is this, and whose title?" They answered, "Caesar's." Then he said to them, "Give therefore to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
This Gospel passage has often been used, or I should say misused, by people who use it as a soapbox to proclaim that there's a huge division, a huge boundary between life in this world and the life of the kingdom of God. And this huge boundary is supposed to force us to choose either we're for God or we're against God. It's become a very common thing in certain political circles in North America. And some preachers who use the gospel in this way are very clear about which side we should be on, and it's usually their side. And they are very clear about what are the issues. And depending on our opinion on these issues, we are either certain of going to heaven or certain of going to hell. If only life could be that simple. If only reality could be that black and white, where right from wrong would be as plain on the nose on our faces. But you and I know that life is not that simple. Moreover, in this gospel, Jesus is not pitting the kingdom of God against the world. There are two sides of the same coin, render to Caesar, render to God. It's not either or. Earlier in Matthew's gospel, we heard the Sermon on the Mount with the beautiful Beatitudes. And in that sermon, Jesus announces a new kingdom, but it is a kingdom not separated from the world, but planted smack dab in the middle of the world. There are no political borders or national borders. It is a kingdom meant to transform the world and build upon it. It's a kingdom where we do give to Caesar what is Caesar's. We do pay taxes. We do work together as a nation for the good of all. We debate things politically. We work for justice. And as members of the kingdom of God, however, we are called to go further. We are called to live in the world, not apart from it, not in conflict with it, but we are called to more. We defend the rule of law, but the gospel challenges also to apply the rule of mercy and forgiveness. It is not enough to send someone to jail for a crime they have committed. The gospel demands that we root out the causes of crime, many of which are to be found in poverty and in abuse. 60% of prisoners in Canada were abused as children. The gospel demands that we do more than simply send people to jail. It is not enough to end abortion and euthanasia. We are called to reach out to support single parents and families to provide care to the infirm and the dying. When our governments call us to work for justice and well-being, we support and we respond. But constantly the gospel calls us to more. It is in this context of Matthew's action of the kingdom that we are to understand today's gospel. Jesus did not come to establish a political kingdom with borders and property to be protected, and immigration boards, to decide who's in and who's out. Some people set themselves up in the church as an immigration board, who gets in, who gets out. Forgive me, Mr. Sullivan, or even canon lawyers. We do not seek to exclude. We seek to bring all into this great kingdom. The blind, the lame, the sinner and the saint, the young and the old, the rich and the poor, and much in the news these days, the divorced and the gay. We seek to bring into the kingdom, not exclude. Jesus did not come to establish a political earthly kingdom. He had no desire to establish borders and boundaries, national or provincial, religious boundaries. He walked over them all the time. Political differences, parish boundaries, none of these things mean anything to the kingdom of God. He had no desire to fight over stuff, over material things, goods, wealth, ownership. His kingdom calls us to greater richness. That being said, we face many challenges today that often seem overwhelming. There are so few young people who feel connected to our church. All across North America and Western Europe, the practice of the faith ranges from 3% in some countries to a high of 27% in the United States. It can be daunting, and it would be overwhelming if we were in this alone, but we are not. In 1991, when I was pastoring Chetia, on New Year's Eve, I celebrated a wedding in the little church of Central Central Magnus, 6 miles south. That night, New Year's Eve, around 11 o'clock, that little church burned down, an electrical fire. Someone took a picture when the church was engulfed in flames, and the picture went all over the community, because in the steeple, very clearly, was this image that was the traditional image of Jesus with the flowing hair and the black beard. You didn't have to struggle to see it. It was striking. Now, I'm not calling that miraculous. I'm circumstantial. Who cares? But it's what happened the following week that I will never forget. We had our first meeting with the kids preparing for First Communion. And the catechist brought that picture in and was showing it to the kids. And she asked one little fellow what he thought it meant. And he looked at it for a minute, and then he said, "It means that even though the building is gone, Jesus is still here. Out of the mouths of babes. Jesus is still here. We are not in this alone. In 100 years, this building will probably be gone. We have no idea what Sydney will look like 100 years from now. But Jesus will still be here. And my friends, therein lies our vocation. Therein lies our work and our task. Today is Mission Sunday. Make no mistake, we don't have to think about going to foreign lands and proclaim the gospel. We are in mission territory here in Sydney. We are to proclaim the gospel to many people who feel no connection to it. And it needs to be done by witness, not just by words. St. Paul says it very clearly in the second reading, you are chosen. He called you, he called me, he called us. It's a wonderful story that was in the Catechist magazine with a little girl drawing a picture. And her mother said, "What are you drawing?" And she said, "I'm drawing a picture of God." And her mother said, "But nobody knows what God looks like." And she said, "They know when I finish this." We are the ones to be finishing the image of God, to be drawing it in our community. People will know what God is like by our behavior, by our reaching out, particularly to those on the periphery, particularly to those who are not welcome elsewhere. And so I am thrilled today that we are placing this church under the patronage of St. Marguerite Bourgeoys, a courageous woman who, at a time in our history when the church was hour jet ride. It was a 32 or 40 day ship voyage with much hardship. This courageous woman who proclaimed the gospel in new ways and in new lands. We are blessed indeed to place this parish church under her patronage. May she intercede for us as we strive to find new ways to the church in the 21st century.
Marguerite Bourgeois Church. Whereas the pastor and pastoral council of St. Marguerite Bourgeois Parish, supported by the parishioners, requested that the name of St. Joseph Church be changed to St. Marguerite Bourgeois Church. Whereas on June 13, 2014, the Diocese of Antigonish sought an indult from the Congregation for Divine Worship and the Discipline of the Sacraments to make this change. Whereas on July 25th, 2014, the Congregation for Divine Worship and Discipline of the Sacraments granted the requested indult, therefore I, Brian Joseph Dunn, Bishop of the Diocese of Antigonish, decree from this day forward the name of this Church of St. Joseph shall be changed to the Church of St. Marguerite Bourgeois, effective today. prayers of the Blessed Virgin Mary and of all the saints, make our prayers acceptable to you. May this altar be the place where the great mysteries of redemption are accomplished, a place where your people offer their gifts, unfold their good intentions, pour out their prayers, and echo every meaning of their faith and devotion. Grant this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Father, we praise you and give you thanks, for you have established the sacrament of true worship by bringing to perfection in Christ the mystery of the one true altar prefigured in those many altars of old. Noah, the second father of the human race, once the waters fell and the mountains peaked again, built an altar in your name. You, Lord, were appeased by his fragrant offering, and your rainbow bore witness to a covenant refounded in love. Abraham, our father in faith, wholeheartedly accepted your word and constructed an altar on which to slay Isaac, his only son. But you, Lord, stayed his hand and provided a ram for his offering. Moses, mediator of the old law, built an altar on which was cast the blood of a lamb, so prefiguring the altar of the cross. All this Christ has fulfilled in the Paschal mystery. As priest and victim, he freely mounted the tree of the cross and gave himself to you, Father, as the one perfect oblation. In his sacrifice, the new covenant is sealed. In his blood, sin is engulfed. Lord, we therefore stand before you in prayer. Bless this altar, built in the house of the church, that it may ever be reserved for the sacrifice of Christ and stand forever as the Lord's table, where your people will find nourishment and strength. Make this altar a sign of Christ, from whose pierced side flow blood and water, which ushered in the sacraments of the church. Make it a table of joy, where the friends of Christ may hasten to cast upon you their burdens and cares and take up their journey restored. Make it a place of communion and peace, so that those who share the body and blood of your Son may be filled with his Spirit and grow in you in your life of love. Make it a source of unity and friendship, where your people may gather as one to share your spirit of mutual love. Make it the center of our praise and thanksgiving until we arrive at the eternal tabernacle, where together with Christ, high priest and living altar, we may offer you an everlasting sacrifice of praise. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
May we now anoint this altar. May Christ in his power make it holy, a visible sign of the mystery of Christ, who offered himself for the life of the world. As incense in your sight, as this building is filled with fragrance, so may your church fill the world with the fragrance of Christ. light of Christ shine on this altar and be reflected by those who share at this table.
Thank you.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, our Almighty Father. May your Holy Spirit come down upon this altar, we pray, O Lord, to sanctify the gifts of your people and graciously to cleanse the hearts of all who receive them through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
Do this in memory of me.
his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ.
May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Marguerite Bourgeoys, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help.
May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth with your servant Francis our Pope and Brian our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own.
Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory. Through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Through him and with him and in him, O God,
Amen.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lord.
Thank you.
Thus, O Lord, ever close to your altar, where the sacrament of sacrifice is celebrated, so that united in faith and charity, we who by Christ are nourished into Christ may be transformed, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen. I'm going to ask you to be seated for a moment, please. This will not take long, but I have a reason to have you seated. We are pleased and privileged to have with us today many of the daughters of Mother Marguerite Bourgeoys. We also have some women religious from the Marquess and other communities. We do not get this opportunity often. I want to invite all of us to show our profound appreciation for the incredible work that these women have given to the church, and especially to the Diocese of Antioch over these many years. Would the sisters please rise?
Glorifying the Lord by your life.
Amen. Amen.